get back the kingdom. It's time to take our stand. Listen, hallelujah, the enemy thought that he had us in 2023, 22, 20, and on beyond, but no. It's my goal to remind you of what you are capable of. Hallelujah. Come on, come on. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Come on. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. My family's blessed. Finance is blessed. My mind is clear. My body's blessed. Come on. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Come on, say it, sing it. Let's get back to Eden. Live on top of the world. Yes, Eden, where you at? My Eden folk, where you at? Those who want to get back to Eden, where you at? Hallelujah. Come on.
Right here.
This ain't the time to give up. God's gonna work it out. So live. Make up your mind that you're going to live. Live. You've been down too long. Hallelujah. Ooh, I can't wait to get into this message. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Listen, okay, if you're listening, tag somebody, share with somebody, because this message is important for this 2024. It's time for you to live. Hallelujah. I know some things are going on, but that's okay, because God has everything under control. Come on, live. Live on top of the world. Live on top of the world. You're more than a conqueror. Hallelujah. Yes. Come on. Come on, walk out of that depression. Walk out of everything that held you back in 2023. Come on, live on top of the world. God has a word for you today. God has a word for you today. A breakthrough, a word of breakthrough, a word of deliverance. Hallelujah. A word of healing. Glory be to God. And I want you to live. Glory be to the God. Live on top of the world. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. Oh, blessed be the name of God. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Live on top of the world. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory to his holy name. Father, we praise you this morning. Well, like I said, we are at the beginning of a new year, and this is the very first sermon that I am preaching under the church, the Christian fellowship that God has entrusted to me, Cyrus Redemption Center. Hallelujah. I want to welcome you, and I want you to know how much I appreciate you for joining me. Now, glory be to God. Hallelujah. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me, if you will, to Deuteronomy chapter 2. Deuteronomy chapter 2. Deuteronomy chapter 2. And I am going to be reading from the New King James Version. And I'm starting at verse 1, and we'll move on down to verse 4. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Then we turned and journeyed into the wilderness of the way of the Red Sea. As the Lord spoke to me, we skirted Mount Seir for many days. And the Lord spoke to me, saying, you have skirted this mountain long enough. Turn northward. You have skirted this mountain long enough. Turn northward. And command the people, saying, you are about to pass through the territory of your brethren, the descendants of Esau who live in Seir, and they will be afraid of you. Mm-hmm. And they will be afraid of you. Therefore, watch yourselves carefully. Oh, there's a message in the message. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Let us pray. Let us pray. Glory be to God. Gracious God, our eternal Father. Here I am again, Lord, your humble servant. Hallelujah. I come before your holy throne of grace this morning. And before I ask anything of you, I want to take the time to say thank you for everything that you are doing, everything that you have done, and everything you plan to do. Thank you so much, God, for your goodness. Thank you so much for your kindness. Thank you so much for your mercy. Now, God, hallelujah, I ask you to help me preach and teach this word that you have placed in my belly. Hallelujah. I ask you to hide me, God, so that the people will only hear, see, and know you in me. Help me to preach your word so that sinners are saved, prodigals will come home, and those who straddle in the fence will make a commitment to you today, and that the body of Christ is edified. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Listen, I will not be before you long, but I do want to share what God has quickened in my spirit. And my subject, is, it's time to move. It is time to move. God says, you have skirted this mountain long enough. Turn northward. Hallelujah. Just at the end of the year, we went to a conference, and the name of the conference, the theme of the conference was, we're going up. Hallelujah. We're going up. We're going up. God said, move northward, move up. Ha, Yeroboshia. Look, God has given us some promises that go beyond our present circumstances. We all got some circumstances. We all got some stuff going on. If you're a child of God, you have some things going on because the enemy just don't like you. Mm-hmm. He just don't like you. But I tell you what, you can depend on every promise God has made in his word, because as it says in 2 Corinthians 1:20, for all the promises of God in him are yes, and in him, amen, to the glory of God through us. Yes. I want you to know that God loves you and God has a plan for your life. In fact, he says in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. God promised Abraham and the nation of Israel the land of Canaan as their possession. Mm-hmm. He promised it to them. That's their possession. He said in Deuteronomy 1 and 8, where Moses was restating the promise that God made to Abraham and his seed. Behold, I have set the land before you. Go in. Go in and possess the land which the Lord swore unto your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give unto you, unto them, and to their seed after them.
Mm-hmm.
Unto you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Listen, if you are a child of God, you have been grafted into that promise. Glory be to God. And you might not God hasn't called you to go in and possess Canaan. But see, Canaan means something in the Bible. It was a land then, but it also means something in the Bible. And it's called the promised land. Hallelujah. God called his people to possess the land. And at this point, in Deuteronomy 2, the Israelites had been wandering and wandering and wandering around in the wilderness for almost 40 years of their journey. A journey that should have taken only 11 days ended up lasting for 40 years. Now, let me ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
Has it seemed as if you've been wandering and not getting ahead, not moving forward? Every time you think you move a little bit further, something happens and it just pulls you back. Am I speaking to anybody today? Hallelujah. There were many reasons, why the Israelites were in the wilderness that long. And I can't talk about them all for the sake of time, but there are a couple that are so important for us to move forward, for us to go up, for us to move, hallelujah, into the things that God has for us, hallelujah, in this season. You know, we call it years, but God calls it seasons. And this is a season, he says, for you to go up north, upward, go north, move up, hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord, thank you for your word. Uh-huh. Now look, the first reason that I see is because there was too much unbelief in the camp. Now, unbelief, if you have unbelief, you cannot get anything from God, because God said, first, you must believe, and then you must believe that he is, and that he will do everything that he says that he will do. A man walking in unbelief should not expect anything from God. So look, God said, and for Israel, I'm going to make sure that the unbelief is purged from the camp before you move into the promised land. Why do you say that? Because first of all, you can't get to the promised land if you don't believe him and follow his instructions.
Mm-hmm.
Second of all, he don't want this unbelief to be in the place where there should be prosperity, where he's bringing you back into the fold with him. He don't want that for you, because it's not that you won't be able to prosper in unbelief. Now, the Bible says something that I find very sad. I really do. Every time I think about it, I try to make sure that I am not walking in the things of Israel, because see, they never received the promise. That first generation, the Bible said that all those people that he delivered out of Egypt died in the wilderness. I don't know if you heard the story, if you read the story, but they all died. And only two of their children went through. And all of those who were born after them, those who were born in the wilderness. And so these people that he split the sea for, that he drowned the army of Egypt for, that he went through and delivered them out of the bondage of Egypt, they never completed the promise. And I want you to know that there is a serious penalty for unbelief. And likely so, because if you don't believe God, you can't receive anything from Him. So let's talk about unbelief and doubt. Now, the first thing I want you to understand is that unbelief and doubt are not the same. No, all of us face doubt at times. Even the most spiritual among us will face doubt. I've been saved a very long time. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. But there are times when I have faced doubt. Doubts are not unbelief. Doubts are an invitation to deepen your faith. When a thought crosses your mind that makes you doubt God, if you accept the doubt, then the doubt can turn into unbelief. Maybe something happened. You know, I've had a lot of things that came through my life that could have caused me to doubt. And that shook my faith. A lot of things shook my faith. You know, people that I was praying for to be healed, and God took them home. People close to me that I love and was praying for, and they seemingly turned against me. All of that will make you doubt that prayer is real, that God is real, that He will do whatever He says He will do. But I praise God that the Holy Spirit did not allow me. He helped me not to let that doubt turn into unbelief. So when those doubts come, you can either accept doubt and let the doubt turn into unbelief, or you can say, devil, you a liar, because he's going to come and he say, nah, God can't heal like he said. See there? God can't do what he said he won't do. See there? God ain't real. If he was so good and if he was real, why did he let that happen? But see, this is your opportunity to trust God. Walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Trust God and say, devil, you a liar. I know in whom I have believed in. I made up my mind. I know who I am in Christ. I know in whom I believe. Even though I don't always understand his ways. I trust that God always has a perfect plan, and his ways are always perfect. I'm persuaded that God, my God, my Father, is truly able to perfect everything that concerns me. You know why? Because he's done it before, and I believe that he'll do it again. Hallelujah. So, devil, you can move on with that foolishness. I understand that. I don't understand why this is happening. But like Job, even though he might slay me, yet I will trust him, because I know in the end, all things work together for my good. I've come to see that when I put God's word in my mouth, when I confess what I know to be true, it deepens my faith. This is the way I've been living for the past few years. I don't know what, 10, 15 years, just living by his word, just living by his word and believing and trusting in God. Yeah. So I'm thankful that even when I was coming up, you know, I used to hear people say, you don't question God. You know, God knows best. Don't question him. Don't question him. And so when things would arise, before I learned better, when things would arise, when I had doubt, I was afraid to say, God, why is this happening? What's going on? You know, what is it that I need to do? Can you fix this? Can you turn this thing around? I was afraid to pray things like that. I just was believing that all I needed to do was just accept whatever was going on. It is what it is. It is what it is, because I can't question God. But look, when I got into the word, I learned that even Jesus had questions. Mm-hmm. He had questions. In the Garden of Gethsemane, when he looked in the cup and saw that taking on the sins of the world, your sins and mine, would cause him to be separated from God, he said, God, Father, let this cup pass from me. Can you let this cup pass from me? Do I really have to do this, Father? Hanging on the cross, he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? But at the end of the day, he said, nevertheless, not my will, Father, but yours be done. Hallelujah. And I am so thankful that he didn't give up. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that Jesus didn't give up? Is there anybody that under the sound of my voice, glad that when doubt came, you didn't let it turn into unbelief? Is there anybody glad that you didn't miss your miracle? Have you had some miracles? I've had some miracles. I've had some miracles. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. God just kept on showing up and showing his mercy. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Hallelujah. I'm glad that God kept his hand on my life. Mm-hmm. Listen, unbelief is something that threatens your future. Mm-hmm. Because it's going to stop God's blessings in your life. Bottom line. Uh-huh. So doubt and unbelief are two separate things. Don't let your doubts turn into unbelief. Let doubt turn you into the Father. Turn you into his word. Glory be to the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The other reason that Israel went through the wilderness, glory to God, uh-huh, for almost 40 years is because there was a process happening in them. Now, God will sometimes work even through your misdirection. Now, I don't know about you, but when I first got saved, things would just happen. It was good. Mm-hmm. Because he had just delivered me and everything was peachy keen for a while. And then I stepped over into the wilderness. We all going to go through a wilderness experience. Okay, but don't let that discourage you. Mm-hmm. So in the midst of that, I made some bad decisions. Mm-hmm. Some of it, I'm not ashamed to say that I kind of steered away from God because I wanted what I wanted and I wanted to do what I wanted to do. Uh-huh. And so I made some bad decisions. I made some wrong turns. But the thing about God is when he has a call on your life, when a plan for you, your bad decisions and your missteps don't disqualify you from what God has planned for you. He's so wise. He's a wise God. That when you and I have made wrong turns, God is faithful, merciful, wise, and loving. That his ways are still accomplish what needs to be done in our life. Isn't that a good God? That's a good Father. Think about you and your children. Mm-hmm. When they made mistakes, you didn't stop loving them. When they did some things that caused them some trouble, you didn't stop loving them. You jumped right in there and did what you could to help them. That's a loving parent. God is a loving parent. Okay, whatever we do, God will use it to work out for our good according to the purpose and the plan that he has for our lives. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. That's a good place to praise him right there. That's a good place. Hallelujah. So many times he has said, Angeline, this is not the way. Angeline, you need to turn around. Daughter, get up out of here. Daughter, turn around. Don't go that way. You are going the wrong way. Maybe in 2023, you made some wrong choices. Hallelujah. Maybe you missed some opportunities. But I can tell you and prophetically declare over you that God's grace is going to help you make a U-turn and redeem the time that you lost. Can you believe God for a turnaround? Say, Father, I believe in Jesus' name. See, we think that we have to think these things. No, but the word of God says that you need to confess with your mouth. So right here, say, Father, I believe that you are going to give me a turnaround so that I can move northward, so that I can go up. Hallelujah. But listen, I think the biggest reason they stayed in the wilderness for 38 years is they got used to it. Mm-hmm. Some of us have been in, and I can say it was me. I can say it was me. Some of us have been in places in the wilderness so long, we just got used to it. Mm-hmm. We just think this is the way it's going to be. Because like I said, there were times when, I heard, don't question God. Don't think about this and don't worry about that. Just accept what comes. And so you just get used to it. And after a while of doing that, you just think, well, ain't nothing good going to happen for me. You ever, oh, woe is me. Uh-huh. You remember that cartoon? I can't remember the cartoon, but I certainly remember Shep Slaprock. Mm-hmm. Slaprock, everywhere he went, he thought that he was bad luck to everybody and nothing good ever happened to him. Uh-huh. Slaprock. Have you ever been like that? Do you know people every time you talk to them? They just complain and complain and complain. Listen, give them the word and keep it moving. Because if you stay around those people, you will find yourself talking and joining in on their complaints. That's what happened with Israel. They complained and complained and complained. God blessed them. God blessed them. God blessed them. He brought water out of rocks. He fed them with manna in the morning, but they got used to the manna. So when the manna stopped, where's the manna, God? God said, I've given this to you long enough. It's time for you to step up. It's time for you to go up. You have skirted around this mountain long enough. Mm-hmm. They had been a slave for 400 years, and it wasn't you. It was their mama, daddy, grandmama, grandpa, great-grandma, great-grandpa. I mean, all down through the generations. Mm-hmm. The slave mentality was passed on. It was passed on. And can I tell you that even today, and I know a lot of people, they don't believe in generational curses, generational sins, generational, but yes, they are. Yes, they are. Daddy was an alcoholic, and you swore up and down that you would not drink liquor, but today you are an alcoholic. And God shared with something with me about that I'm studying out this morning about 4:30. Wow. And so he gave me my next message. So I want you to begin to follow me and follow this ministry, and so that, because there's a lot that God wants you to do. This is a ministry for breakthrough. This is a ministry for healing. This is a deliverance ministry. And I'm not talking about all that spooky stuff. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, we're not talking about all that spooky stuff. But see, God, it is God's plan for you to live on top of the world. It is God's plan for you to get back to Eden. What was Eden? It was a place of prosperity and freedom and liberty. And that's the buzzword that he gave me for 2024. And then not just for me, but for everybody that I talk to. Freedom, freedom, freedom from everything that the enemy has bound you in. You might not want to admit it, but truthfully, you are bound in something. Everybody has something. And yes, you are saved, but there's something that's holding you back. And if you're not walking in the things of God, if you're not receiving all of those blessings, then something is standing in your way. And God wants you to move beyond that. He wants you to step over that, step out of that, and go up. Glory be to God. Child of God, listen, you are not a possession of the enemy. If after you've been bound for so long, you begin to think that this is just how it is. But God wants you to know you are not a possession. Mm-hmm. I don't care how long you've been using drugs. Drugs don't own you. I don't care how many people you slept with. Promiscuity does not own you. Uh-huh. I don't care how many times you fail or how long the devil has bound you, had you bound. You are not a possession of the enemy. Mm-hmm. You are a possessor. Say, I'm a possessor of the promised places. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation. You are not a possession of the enemy. Uh-huh. God told the children of Israel, you can go and read about it in Exodus chapter 12 when you get some time. But for now, I'm just going to tell you the story. God told them, I'm going to bring you out of Egypt. I'm going to deliver you from what has you bound. I'm going to set you free from what thought it owned you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to set you free from what thought it owned you. And I'm going to do it with the blood of the Lamb. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And so here are your instructions, Israel. Mm-hmm. Here are your instructions. I want each household to take a lamb without blemish, a male of the first year. And I want you to keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then I want you to cut it and put the blood of the lamb on your doorpost. See, God is very strategic. Now, did you hear him? He said, keep the lamb until the 14th day. Because see, he had a plan in place. And you got to follow his plan if you want to receive his blessing. Mm-hmm. He said, cut the lamb and place the blood on your doorpost. Mm-hmm. He said, and I am going to pass through the land of Egypt on that night, on that 14th day. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Glory. Hallelujah. And I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt will I execute judgment. Sound kind of mean? Uh-huh. But see, the Pharaoh had already gone through the land and killed all the firstborn, right? Mm-hmm. So now, I am the Lord, he says. Now the blood on your house will be a sign. And when I see the blood, mm-hmm, when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Now listen, can I tell you that when God slayed the firstborn of Egypt, he was announcing to Israel, and everything in your future that will come to try to bind you up, that feels it's entitled to have ownership over you, because of the blood, you will not be able to rise up to claim ownership of this one, because I see the blood on them. They belong to me. So you cannot own them. Hallelujah. Do I need to repeat that for you? Glory be to God. When God struck the firstborn of Egypt, what was he doing? He was killing out everything that thought it had a entitlement to you. Glory be to God. Because of the blood of Jesus, the devil has to pass over you in the name of Jesus. But see, do you believe that? Because do you believe that? Hallelujah. But sometimes when you leave the place of slavery, it's hard to leave the posture of slavery. Do you know what I mean? Listen, so now they were no longer in Egypt, but they felt like slaves. And the wilderness became their home. And it really is just a few days trip, but they stayed there 38 years. They were still thinking that they were slaves. God sent me to tell somebody, you've been walking around that same circle long enough. Mm-hmm. For too long. If you're not careful, that circle becomes a pattern. That pattern becomes a mentality. That mentality becomes an expectation. You don't even expect anything good. You expect everything to go wrong. Hallelujah. Because it went wrong. It's been going wrong all these years. And so now, despite what God is saying, you can't accept what God is saying, but you're accepting what you see with your natural eyes. With your natural eyes, you accepting what you see. I remember there was something that I heard say, believe half of what you see and none of what you hear. Talking about worldly things now, not what God, because see, God wants us, we're spirit beings and we're supposed to live in the spirit. So we're supposed to see in the spirit. Hallelujah. And we're children of God. So we're supposed to hear his voice, not those other voices. Cause there are a lot of voices that speak to you in the run of a day, a lot of voices, but the voice that you really want to pay attention to is the voice of the Lord. And Jesus said, my sheep know my voice. Mm-hmm. My sheep know my voice. Glory be to God. Christians are not just saved. Mm-hmm. Just to sit. Till they go to heaven. You are not dead. You're just not possessing. That's it. Christians are saved to become possessors. Say, I'm a possessor. Hallelujah. I am a possessor. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. I am a possessor. Hallelujah. I am the head and not the tail. You got to say it. You got to confess it. I am the head and not the tail. I don't belong to this poverty. I don't belong to this sickness. This is not my portion. Hallelujah. I am a possessor of the promise. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And John chapter 5. And you probably know the story. There's a story of a paraplegic man who was sitting at the pool of Bethesda. Now listen, it's important. Whenever God puts a name in something, it's important that we understand what that is. So at the pool of Bethesda, there are five porches. Five is the number of grace, right? Mm-hmm. And it was near the sheep gate. And this is a place where the blind, the impotent, those who had some kind of issues going up would show up. Mm-hmm. This is a picture of the church. The church is not a gathering place for gossip, a gathering place to come and see who got on what, gathering place to come in and it's all right to make friends, but this is not the gathering place for that. The church is a hospital. It's the place where those who need the Lord, those who have problems going on, show up. God's word is a healing word. Uh-huh. He said it's medicine unto your soul, medicine to your bones. Glory be to God. The church is a hospital for people who need deliverance, who need healing, who need a mind change, people who need God. That's what the church is. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. It's not for a specific group of people who think that they're above everybody. No, 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 no. All of us need Jesus. Glory be to God. And all of us are going through the process. Hallelujah. So, that's where the paraplegic man sat. He sat at the pool of Bethesda. And the Bible says that Jesus comes and asks him, will thou be made whole? And just like the Israel and just like the man at the pool of Bethesda, sometimes if we take real inventory of our life, we'll come to the conclusion that our future has been in our hands all the time. What was Jesus saying? Jesus said, you know, you could have been got up from there. Mm-hmm. You said, I have no man to put me in the water. Because see, every now and then the angel would come. And that's why the people would gather there, because the angel would come and trouble the water. And whoever was able to get in the water, they would be healed. Mm-hmm. So the man, paraplegic, said, I have nobody to put me in there. I have no one to help me. I have nothing. There's nothing that I can actually do for myself to get there, to get this healing. I don't know about you, but there is, I've seen paraplegic people, people in wheelchairs, people they don't let it stop them, people without arms running races, people who are doing things who the world would think, oh, how could you ever do that? But they are moving beyond the ability of what everything that holds them back. Mm-hmm. They don't let the obstacle stop them. And I'm telling you today, don't let the obstacle stop you. God has a plan for you. Mm-hmm. Ah, glory. See, instead of the paraplegic man, he continued to rehearse his problems. Now, let me ask you something. What are you going to do for 2024? Are you going to continue to rehearse your problems? Are you going to talk about them another year? Are you going to blame God, get mad at God, blame your mama, blame your brother, blame whoever? That boss don't like me. You know, every time I walk around or come around this person, they just don't like me. Are you going to let these perceptions block you from moving forward, going up, going northward? You know, northward is up. Hallelujah. But greater. Are you going to walk out of unbelief into what God has promised you? Yeah, there are going to be some giants. I told you in the beginning, you a child of God. And so the enemy just don't like you. So he's going to do everything he can. He's going to throw doubts in there. He's going to try to put this in your path and that in your path to make you doubt and believe that God is not who he said he is. Same thing. He has no new tactics. Okay. Read the story in Egypt. I'm sorry. In Genesis about Eve and Adam. How he came and he threw a monkey wrench in there and caused them, unfortunately, to believe what he said. He made Eve think that God is withholding something from her when he said all things that pertain to godliness belong to you. Now, he's not going to give you nobody else's husband. Don't try it. He's not going to give you stuff for you to go and steal from nobody. Don't try it. Okay. But now if you need a job, if you need income, if you need provision, that he will do. Glory be to God. He said, come on, it's time to move. You circle around this mountain long enough. It's time to move northward. It's time to go up. It's time to move for your marriage. Hallelujah. You don't have to sit there and allow the enemy to come in and destroy your marriage. Glory be to God. It's time to move for your business. Glory be to God. It's time to move for your children. It's time to move and make a move for yourself. Quit hating on yourself. Quit hating on yourself. No, I don't care what they said about you. It's a lie. If it don't line up with God, what God has said, it is a lie. It's time to quit hating and destroying your own life. Tell yourself, this is my last day at the foot of this mountain. Hallelujah. It's time for me to move. Glory be to God. God said it's time for you to move. It's time for you to get back to Eden. Now, here's the thing. If you're not in Christ, then God can't help you. Because the first step you got to take is get in Christ. Because the blessings, as we said earlier, are in him. The blessing of God is in him. Now, I know you done heard all kind of things about Christ. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's just a prophet. He's just this. He's just that. Uh-huh. And he didn't come. I heard somebody tell me, ain't nobody came to die on the cross for your sins. That's a lie. That is a lie. And see, here's the thing about lies. You don't have to believe them. You don't have to believe him. So, I've always been of the mindset, well, if that were true, what does it hurt me to believe? If it was true that he didn't come, what does it hurt me to believe that he did? If I believe that he did, And when I get to heaven, when I leave here, I have lost nothing if I believe, but I've gained eternal life. But if I don't believe, and when I leave here, because all of us gonna do it, then I have lost everything, because I will be forever separated from God. But if I believe and I leave here, I will spend eternity with God, a new life, continue to live, and I'll live in heaven in Eden, where things are not what the Bible declares the hell as a place that was actually created for the devil and his angels. But now that the devil wants, you ever heard that saying, misery loves company? Mm-hmm. The devil wants you to be there with him. And that hell is just a place of torment. Heaven is a place of love. Hallelujah. So which do you want, love or torment? You decide. It's your decision. Jesus said, this day, choose whom you will serve. And he said, choose life. So today I ask you, if you're ready to move up, if you're backslidden, if you never accepted Christ into your heart, this is the perfect day to do it. Give God a chance. Give him a chance to change. If you're tired of what's been happening over the last few years, if you're tired of going around in circles, it's time for you to, when I first moved to Atlanta, I used to get lost because I'm from Miami. And in Miami, we have street numbers. In Atlanta, you can be at the red light and you got one name and cross the street and there's another name of the same street. And so I used to get lost a lot. But I learned if I went around 285, then I can find my way home because it's just a circle around the city. But listen, you can't circle 285 forever. You're going to have to get off at your exit. Glory be to God. And so that's what I'm telling you today. It's time to stop circling that mountain. It's time to stop circling that mountain of lack. It's time to stop circling that mountain of hate and depression. It's time to stop circling that destructive marriage, circling that thing that's causing destruction in your marriage, that bitterness. Hallelujah. It's time to stop circling that stuff. So if you want to be free today, just call on Jesus. Hallelujah. You can say something simple. Lord God, forgive me. Forgive me for turning away. Forgive me for my sins. I believe that you died on the cross for my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead so that I can be redeemed back to God. I need you to help me live a life that will take me off of this circle. Something simple like that. See, we make things so complicated, but it's just a simple thing. Ask Jesus to help you. Tell him that you believe. Ask him to forgive you for your sins. Mm-hmm. And then find a church home. Glory be to God. I told you that Cyrus Redemption Center is a brand new church. And I'm so glad that God has moved us into this place. We are a teaching ministry. You probably are never, I don't know, I ain't going to say never, but it won't be often where you'll hear me hooping and hollering and doing all of that. Mm-mm, not here. Mm-hmm. Because see, that hooping and hollering, that's what's keeping us, some of that is keeping us around the mountain. Glory be to God. And God says it's time for you to move up, go northward. And so we teach the word. That's the goal. I've been preaching for a long time and it's always been the word. It's always been bringing you out of captivity. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. And so if you need healing, if you need breakthrough, reach out. It's just that simple. If you need prayer, reach out. It's just that simple. We have our location. If you really want to join us in Sunday services, then inbox me, reach out, and I'll give you the location. It's like a cell church right now. We're just starting out. And honestly, I need people to help me grow. Mm-hmm. And so the Holy Spirit is our lead. He's our guide. And so if you need a church home, if you want to, if you receive Christ today and you live in the Atlanta area, Metro Atlanta area, you need a church home, come on. I would be glad to fellowship with you. I would be glad to be your pastor. Hallelujah. I would be honored to help you grow in Christ. I would be honored to see you move forward and go northward. Amen. So I appreciate you standing with us today. I appreciate you listening in. You can go back and you can re-listen and re-listen and re-listen as much as you want. Share the message with somebody. Share the ministry with somebody. And again, if you need anything, reach out, DM me, send a private message. That's what they call it. And let's see what we can get together. Glory be to God. I'd be honored to pray. I would be honored to love on you. I would be honored to fellowship with you. Glory be to God. Thank you. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm.